We're live on this beautiful, sunny and warm evening in Wales, bringing you a show which is absolutely packed with wildlife that we find on this beautiful reserve.
We've got a Springwatch first, incredible underwater footage of gannets. They really are the gold medalists of the seabird diving world, a truly awesome bird.
It's only day two, but already there's been high drama in the lives of the animals we've been following. There've been sinister goings-on down at the jackdaw nest. Someone's intent on mayhem. What is gonna happen? Stay with us to find out, because it's Springwatch.
I lied. It's absolutely pouring with rain. I'm terribly sorry. We failed to get complete control of the weather, but nevertheless, welcome to programme two of Springwatch for our 2013 series. We're here at the beautiful, although it's wet, RSPB Ynys Hir Reserve in Wales, and this is in a fabulous part of the country. It's nestled down in here in the Dovey Estuary. In amongst all of those fields, that greenery and all of those woods are 700 hectares of one of the best managed nature reserves that I've ever had the privilege of visiting, I've got to say. It's great to be here. We've bugged it. All of the birds that we've got on our nest are now under close scrutiny, and we're unravelling the secrets of their family lives. Although I must tell you, tonight, you need to be of a tough disposition, because some of those secrets, some of those stories are tumultuous.
Now, I've got a serious question for you both. Is it a late spring? Yes, I think it is.
It's gone straight to autumn, I think.
It's an early winter.
It's certainly a very wet, damp-looking spring today. And we're going to be talking more about the effects of the late and very unusual spring that we've been having and see how it affects all our animals. But first, we've had a lot going on our real stars of the show, the nest birds, the nesting birds. And let us introduce you, well, we did yesterday, to the jackdaws. Now, they've got two chicks. There they are, little faces peeking out. Because let's remind you, on Springwatch, it really is nature that writes the script, and already it's getting dramatic. Yesterday, this is what we saw, two intruding jackdaws coming into the nest box. That's the adult chasing them off. Well, they didn't stop. This morning, just in the early hours of this morning, 14 times they came back. There are the chicks inside, all alone. In comes the intruder, and watch what happens now. It starts to get very aggressive. That adult is pecking the chicks, it's stamping on them. We were wondering yesterday if they were just being inquisitive. Clearly, they're not. That is aggression. The adult, the parent, comes back, chases them off. Now, we're all wondering if the chicks are okay. They don't look very good. I should think they're completely shell-shocked by what's happened. The other parent comes back with some food, goes in. One of them straight up, obviously okay, it's begging for food. The other one, is it okay? It doesn't look good. Yes, thank goodness for that. It lifts its head up. But that is not good. That is definitely something to be concerned about.
Well, it is if you're the parents of those jackdaws. But what about the pair of jackdaws that's coming in because they haven't got a nesting space? And that's what we think's happening here. Jackdaws are very hierarchical socially, and it's likely that the two birds that are coming in and attacking those youngsters have failed to get a nest this year because they're low down the social order. Their only chance, perhaps, of being able to breed next year is to nab a nest site now. That's why they're going in there. And it's not unusual for jackdaws to kill the young of others and take them out and then claim that nest site. Now, what these young have got going in their favour is their size, I think. They are about half grown, so they're quite robust. This means they can withstand a certain degree of pecking. And also, the adults have invested a lot of time, effort and energy in their care. So they're going to fight very vigorously to keep them alive. So I think if there are any chicks in any nest that are going to withstand these sorts of attacks, then these ones have got the right profile to do so.
It's definitely a nest to keep an eye on. Let's have a look at them live, see what they're doing right now. Well, look at the rain. You can see it's live, can't you? Fortunately, they are covered. And Well, that's interesting, because the adult is brooding them. That's probably because they're a little bit delicate now after that attack, and cold.
It's cold. That's the thing. It's been cold here again all day, compared to the normal temperatures at this time of year, so that's why they'll be brooding.
Fingers crossed for those chicks.
Slightly worried about them. Right, let's move on to a quiz. We've got a little quiz for you. Now, can you see those? Very small. What are they? And let me just turn one around for you. What are they and what has made them? There you go. And if you could, if you know that, get in contact with us, bbc.co.uk/springwatch or hashtag springwatch and tell us if you know. We will reveal all later. They're quite tough, actually. Now, yesterday we met the buzzards on their nest here and we were asking the question, would that extra egg hatch out? There was one chick and one egg. Let's have a look live at the buzzards. And as a... it's a bit of a soggy sight.
Shame,
once again. But, of course, it's terribly important that, that probably the female buzzard, should sit there and protect the chick and that egg. Has it hatched out? We weren't sanguine. We didn't think it was going to, but we pre-recorded it. Let's have a look at what happened earlier today. Sure enough, there's the chick. The other egg hasn't hatched out, so that means it's not going to hatch out now, which is sad, but that does mean that it's going to be an easier job for the parents to feed the chick. Now, just have a listen now. Yes, that's corvids, jackdaws, crows in the background. No wonder the parent looks a bit nervous. There's always that persistent danger from those crows. And here she is being fed a shrew, which surprises me. Chris, a shrew, a lot of birds avoid shrews, don't they?
They do. They've got distasteful glands. A lot of things avoid eating shrews, not just birds, but mammals too. So it's unusual to see them in. But then the old buzzard has got such a broad and Catholic diet that it will eat all sorts of things.
So we look at its diet.
And very pertinent that we've got a small mammal there, because if you've been watching our recent watches, our recent watches, you'll know that we have a rodentorium. Yes, it's an idea that we pinched from one of our viewers. What does it look like? Well, this is it. It's a hollow log. And on one end, we put some cameras pointing into that log, and we've set it up quite close to our production village. Let's cut live to the interior of our rodentorium now. And you can see inside there, there's masses of bait. When it comes to baiting animals, we're not cheapskates on Springwatch. There's a bountiful supply of food in there. Of course, what we're hoping is that this rodentorium will attract rodents. What's it had so far? Well, not much at this time of day, but during the night, we've seen these animals. Wood mice feasting on that supply of seeds and nuts that we put in there. Not only wood mice, though, we've had a common shrew, same species as you saw those buzzards with. I like this bit. Look, watch, as it goes up to the top here, just watch, it breathes out. And you can see a little puff of shrew breath. Now, when was the last time you saw a little puff of shrew breath live on TV? Fantastic. And then the shrew went off with a nut, which was pretty odd, because these are insectivorous animals. If you want to see more activity in there, you can stick with it, because it will be live on our webcams 24/7, and, of course, you can also check it out on Red Button. And it won't just be wood mice and shrews, we hope, because if you were watching during Winter Watch, you'll know that we got a pine marten. A predator went in because it smelled those rodents. So it's fingers crossed that we get something like a stoat or a weasel in the rodentorium.
Absolutely fantastic. Now, also on the website, there's all sorts of information about the Summer of Wildlife, which we launched last night. Now, the Summer of Wildlife, there's a huge range of activities and information to help you get out there and enjoy our lovely wildlife. Now, we keep pushing you to go outside and enjoy the wildlife. I'm going to take my own advice and I'm going to...
You're very brave.
Go outside and go to a brand new area, perhaps a rather surprising area, and look for a bit of extra wildlife. So, will you excuse me?
Put your hood up, you're going to get wet.
I'm going to get absolutely sodden. See you later.
Well, the lovely Yolo Williams has also been out and about a bit further away than Martin's going. He's gone up to a very special island on the east coast of Scotland to experience and find out more about the success of one of UK's true wildlife spectacles.
This is Bass Rock, and at this time of year, the island comes alive with tens of thousands of gannets.
I've come here to find out more about the lives of these extraordinary seabirds. This has got to be one of the UK's greatest wildlife spectacles. In spring, Bass Rock turns white as the gannets fly in from spending the winter further south. They all arrive with one thing in mind.
It's the breeding season, and each and every bird on the island will have returned to exactly the same spot and to exactly the same partner.
Gannets mate for life, and they are remarkably long-lived.
A pair can be together for 30, almost 35 years, and amongst gannets, divorce is incredibly rare. They're very faithful birds.
Although they may have been together for decades, couples perform an elaborate greeting every single time they meet.
There's a little bit of courtship going on here now. Pair bonding, here we go. They'll fence like this with the beaks, they'll waggle their heads.
It's a real privilege to see such intimate moments like this between pairs of these magnificent seabirds. But with so many birds crammed so closely together, the odd squabble is inevitable.
Each pair will have its own little territory and a nest in that, and they're all about a gannet's neck's length apart. Because they'll fight. They're quite vicious birds defending their own little patch.
The sheer numbers here are remarkable. At the peak of the season, when the eggs hatch, more than 150,000 birds are jam-packed onto this tiny island. With so many gannets, you can smell Bass Rock long before you can see it.
You never forget a visit to the middle of a gannet colony. You can close your eyes, because the sound is unique and the smell is unique too.
Although it doesn't look like it on a day like today, this year's long cold winter has been punishing for many of the UK's seabirds. But looking at the numbers there, it seems the gannets on Bass Rock are doing well. To find out why this might be the case, I'm meeting a man who has a unique insight into the lives of these birds. Back in the 1960s, Brian Nelson spent 3 years living on Bass Rock.
Some of my best memories are being in the middle of the gannetry. The noise is just spectacular. I mean, it's intoxicating.
Brian's passion for gannets remains undimmed. Now 81, he's still considered the world expert.
I was supposed to be studying blackbirds in Oxford, and I found it so boring. And when I tried to find out about gannets, I found that they had never been studied. Here and here was Britain's possibly the most dramatic seabird in the whole of Britain, but its basic biology was a closed book. And so I decided that was what I wanted to study, and it was the best decision I ever made.
With the help of his wife, June, Brian's research on Bass Rock forms the basis of just about everything we know about gannets.
You can't get to grips with ecology and life history with odd visits. You know, you have to know your subject intimately.
And would you spend most of your working day just studying gannets?
Absolutely. We worked the whole of the day and writing up stuff into the night. It was just non-stop.
Brian's years of dedicated observation leave him with little doubt about what makes these birds so resilient.
Gannets, of all British seabirds, have a unique feeding niche. They're the only British seabird that can travel hundreds of miles from base and dive deeply. No other British seabird can do that. So they have access to a huge food supply, which is, you know, unique.
From what Brian says, it sounds like I should take a closer look at the gannet's hunting strategy. Most of their feeding is done far out at sea. And to find out why their hunting technique is so effective, I'm going to have to get into the water with them.
the glamour of TV. It's absolutely boring. What a wonderful film. I was talking to Yolo a little bit earlier on. I'm so jealous that he actually got out to Bass Rock. And by the way, Yolo will be with us later on. So if you've got any questions for him, just send them in, bbc.co.uk/springwatch or hashtag springwatch, and he will try to answer them. Well, here we are in the farmyard, complete with proper cows. Well, what sort of a place would this be for wildlife? Why would we come here? Well, actually, it's a great place for wildlife because there's all sorts of shelter everywhere and it's not too manicured, this farmyard, so there's lots of possibilities of getting food. So let's have a little look and try and see what sort of things might we find in our farmyard. Loads of wildlife. It's lovely. Now, when we first arrived, there was something super special here because I don't know if you can see, there's a sort of little rock face there, just over there. And when we appeared here, when we went past it, there was all this tweeting and chirping going on, and there was a very, very unusual nest there. Let's just have a look at what we recorded. Here's the nest, just in that rock face. Look at that beautiful bird. That's a grey wagtail, but there's also a yellow wagtail, which is a lot more yellow. I always want to call them yellow wagtails. There were five chicks in this nest, constantly wagging it, that lovely lemon yellow. Now, this is strange because this is a bird that you'd find by running water, by a stream, and they're feeding on insects often off running water by a stream. So what on earth? There it is fledging. What are they doing here by the farmyard? Well, I think it's because there's lots and lots of insect life and they fed on that. As you see, they are actually fledging. This happened over the weekend. There's a youngster there trying to get its first meal for itself, but it gives up and has to wait for mum to get it. You can see they're bobbing already. They never stop wagging their tails, these wagtails. And they think it may be, no, to be honest, nobody really, really knows why they wag their tails, but they think it might be that it's wagging to break up its body shape against running water. It's sort of camouflage, but nobody's quite sure. Right, there's one more nest here. Watch out for this dung pile. Lovely place for lots of insects. Come up here, because there's a second nest which hasn't fledged. In fact, they haven't even hatched out now. I don't know if you can see up there, there's a sort of post and a gate down there. Well, there is another nest. Let's go live to that nest. Just creep in. I don't know if you can see it there. There it is. There's a mallard there. Just to the left of the picture, there's a mother mallard. Poor thing. Well, actually, ducks, water, it's fine. Now, we don't know how many eggs she's sitting on. We haven't disturbed her. She's sitting really nice and tight to protect those eggs. But we filmed her earlier on. Let's have a look at mum. Of course, mum does all the incubation. There she's sitting on the eggs. Look at that beautiful, sizzling speculum there. What a beautiful... Now, this is lovely. When she leaves the nest, the mother just covers all the eggs up with lovely warm down, and she often plucks those feathers off her very own chest. There she is. So there we are. We'll keep a very careful eye on that nest down there. Now, the only problem for her is that, yes, this is quite a nice place to be, but there are a lot of potential threats to her and her chicks. There are lots and lots of corvids, those crows. It's like seen from the birds around here sometimes. There are rats everywhere. They'd have the eggs, they'd have the chicks. That naughty jackdaw. Highly intelligent, always on the lookout. There are sentries posted all around. And here we are. This isn't library footage or something. We filmed this fox just a couple of days ago. So that mallard mum's going to have to be very careful. Touch wood, so far everything's fine. There's one final thing. Look, what she's got to do, she's got to walk those ducklings when they hatch out across here And all the way down there, just underneath the trees, that's where the river is. She's got to get them down to the water. So hopefully she'll be able to do it. We'll keep a very careful eye on that. Anyway, now it's time to peer in to the mysterious life of another animal making its way down to the water, this time to breed.
This is the story of an extraordinary journey made by a daring heroine, a female common toad. Her mission is to ensure the survival of her kind. But the route ahead will be fraught with danger. It's early spring, and in the wood, life is returning after months of winter. This female toad has spent the last 6 months hidden away, surviving on her stored fat reserves. But now her long hibernation is over. Her sensitive skin detects extra moisture in the surrounding soil and the rise in temperature to a balmy 7 degrees. The time has come. She must start the journey tonight. Under cover of darkness, she makes her move. Guided by a memory of where her own life started, she sets off in search of water. To a toad, the forest floor is an extreme obstacle course. Unlike frogs, toads can't hop, and the going is tough. But she won't let anything stand in her way, and despite not eating for 6 months, there's no time to stop and feed. She isn't alone in the woods. Tonight, thousands of other toads are also making this annual migration. And this hasn't gone unnoticed. Although the toads use the cover of darkness, nocturnal hunters are on the prowl. Our female will march the equivalent of a marathon in her quest to reach water. But her pace is slow, and she must reach the pond before dawn. Finally, she reaches the end of the woods. But now she faces her most dangerous obstacle. It's thought that around 10,000 toads get squashed on the UK's roads every year during their migration. But help is at hand. And our toad is one of the lucky ones. Across the country, around 1,400 toad patrollers man over 400 crossings, keeping at least some toads out of danger. Thanks to their help, she's now making excellent progress. From smelling the air, she knows her pond is close, and her pace quickens. But just ahead, an ambush. Male toads. Smaller and lazier than females, they're trying to hitch a ride. Special nuptial pads on his toes help him hang on to her. Male toads can outnumber females by 3 to 1. By grabbing a female now, he isn't just getting a free ride. He's trying to make sure he's in a position to breed, But our female must now battle on, carrying an extra load of half her body weight. They've made it. Finally, she can do what she's come here for. She lays a double string of up to 5,000 eggs, which the male fertilizes. A huge amount, but only one in 400 of these will make it through to adulthood. She's exhausted, but her amazing journey is complete. She's beaten the odds and left her own legacy.
Do you know, I've always admired a female toad. You know, they're determined, they're fit, they're strong, they're dominant. Strong characteristics, I like that.
You've modelled yourself on female toads, have you?
Yeah. No.
Luckily not your complexion. Luckily not your complexion.
But let's have a look at how this late spring has affected toads. Well, it has affected them. According to Frog Life, one of our conservation partners, most of them have spawned about 5 weeks late this year. They usually begin at the beginning of March. Some of them did start to move about that time. Then they stopped. Then there was a peak for a couple of days around mid-April. Now, how has that actually affected the toads? Well, there's positives and negatives. Interestingly enough, once they did start to migrate, the clocks had changed, which meant they were crossing the roads later in the dark after the rush hour. So perhaps less squashed toads on the roads. But the negative is possibly, and we don't know yet, but remember, those female toads are carrying their eggs. It's 20% of their body weight, and they don't eat until they spawn. So if spawning is too late, they give up and they reabsorb the eggs. This is something that happened last spring as well. So if it did happen to a lot of toads this spring, could be a problem for the population?
It could be a problem. 10% of our toads that live near roads get run over. And the toads there normally only live for 3 or 4 years, whereas away from major roads, a toad can live for 40 years, in which case it wouldn't be a problem. But of course, with an increase in our traffic, then it could impact on some of our urban and suburban toads. Fingers crossed it doesn't. Now, if you're watching yesterday, we introduced you to a nest that I never thought I'd see on Springwatch. An extraordinarily rare bird, a shy and skulking species, the water rail. We found it here on our mire, an area that we've moved to explore this year. Here is the female. We presume the female here sat on the nest, and you can see how well hidden it is in the reeds and also how close it is to the water. Now, it's been pouring rain for the last couple of days here. The water level will be going up, albeit marginally at the moment. But what these birds do to cope with this is they constantly add to their nest. And if the water comes up quite significantly, as this bird is doing here, they'll build that platform up so that they can raise it right above the surface of the water. Let's go live now to see just how wet our water rail is. And there, presumably, she is. You saw her blinking there. You can see her little eyelid was closed. She's dozing. Water droplets on the back, nice and waterproof, of course. Incubating the eggs. We think that there are perhaps 7 eggs in that nest. But of course, it's difficult when you get a view like this to appreciate exactly what the bird's anatomy is like. So luckily, we've had some pictures sent in to our Flickr group, and they are excellent because they reveal the bird out in the open. And typically, we don't see this very often. This one is from Keith Cochran. Thank you very much, Keith. That's pretty good. And this one is from Knots X Minor. And there you can see and appreciate how these birds are members of the rail family and quite closely related to things like moorhens and coots and so on and so forth.
If we get a chick, you'll be down there with your camera, won't you, to get a photograph?
Oh, if those eggs, the magnificent 7, hatch, I shall be elated. A young water rail, that would be something on Springwatch.
Well, close to the water rail, our nest finders found another little bird. It's an unassuming little brown bird. It's a dunnock. Here we go, there's the dunnock, and it was
in the reeds there. It's got, well, actually not in the reeds, it was in the shrubbery. It's got five chicks. All were doing very well, and both parents were coming in and feeding them regularly. Until this happened. There are the chicks begging for food because they know something is coming towards the nest, and it's a hungry weasel. It takes the first chick, the chick's struggling a little bit, I'm afraid, comes back. One by one, it takes the chicks out of the nest. And this whole thing took 1 minute, 7 seconds. Now, it's easy to look at the weasel and paint it as the bad guy, but remember, this is spring. So many animals are fighting for survival. It's likely that that weasel has its own nest with its own little babies in that it's got to feed. And unfortunately, it's feeding them on our dunnock chicks. But of course, that dunnock will probably mate again. This is wildlife, this is what happens. The weasel looks around a bit, but what happens next? It's a little bit sad because the parent comes back. What does it see? It sees an empty nest, I'm afraid.
I know. A lot of people out there will be thinking that weasel should go straight to hell because somebody got murdered. But frankly, that's how it happens. That's the story of life. You know, the weasel might have had a hungry nest, and it won't have wasted those chicks. It would have killed them and stashed them, and it will return to them. You've got to think of it as going to a supermarket and finding it full of food. When you go shopping, you don't buy one can of beans and then go home. You take five cans of beans with you. So it's cruel and it's harsh in one way, but it's the cycle of life, and that's what it's all about in springtime. And of course, there are other nests down on the mire there which are equally vulnerable. Let's take a look at our reed bunting. Let's go live to that nest. You see, lightning strikes not once but twice sometimes. And these birds, the reed buntings, have an astonishing failure rate. Sometimes between 50 and 80% of their nests fail before they fledge. And that's due to weasels and stoats and crows and grass snakes and all sorts of things like that. But they do have strategies which allow them to escape that predation, and we'll tell you a bit more about that tomorrow. Fingers crossed, of course, that they're still there.
Well, hopefully the weasel doesn't find that nest as well. Now, fortunately, some birds build their nests away from predators, but sometimes it does mean their nest can look a little bit precarious. I visited one such nest nearby at the weekend. In and around the reserve, there are so many different habitats that are great for wildlife, but this one is one of my favourites. And you can certainly hear it before you can see it, but it is absolutely beautiful. It's the waterfall on the River Anian. Obviously, there's loads of different animals all around the river, but there's one particular bird that we spotted on a nest just by the waterfall. And if we're lucky, we might see it flit across. The bird I'm looking for is the dipper.
You filming, Lindsay?
No.
And wildlife cameraman Lindsay McRae has been keeping an eye on one particular family.
And the nest is, what, is it right in the moss?
Yeah, just behind this outcrop here.
Yeah.
You'll see him come up.
Oh, there he is.
See him on the edge of that rock? Watch where he goes there. You can hear the chicks now screaming.
And it's got a mouth full of food for the chicks.
Oh, there he goes.
Oh, there he goes. Do you know how old the chicks are?
Well, they were here when we first got here 2 weeks ago, but they were young, so they're roughly 2 weeks old. So
probably another week to go before they fledge.
Yeah, yeah. We should start to see them hanging out in the nest, and we'll know exactly sort of how old they're getting. So.
And what are they feeding on mainly here?
Well, they've been coming back with all sorts. I mean, mainly in a river like this, you'd find caddis and stoneflies under the rocks, which is what they'll feed on. But they've been coming back with dragonfly larva, damselfly larva. I mean, clearly this river's packed with life.
Do you know how many chicks are in there?
No, I mean, usually they'll have sort of 3, 4 or 5. Certainly won't be any more than that.
I suppose it's so well hidden, it's difficult to see them until they come out.
Yeah, it's perfect, isn't it? I mean, unless the birds were there, you'd have no idea that that nest was
absolutely no idea.
Doesn't it look lovely, just sat in that water with food in its mouth waiting?
They usually have two broods. Do you know if this is the first or second?
I think this is probably still their first, because these are a lot later than they usually would be, but everything's been put back with this spring, so I'm pretty sure that this is still their first.
They're known for being early breeders, aren't they? Sometimes as early as February, yeah, but like so many birds, they're really late.
Yeah, these things have been hit, and certainly when we arrived, the river was a lot higher than it is now. So I think they've been quite lucky to last as long as they have done.
I love a dipper, me, because somehow whenever you see a dipper, you're in a beautiful place, some quiet little stream or something like that. And dippers, well, we'll have to keep a careful eye on that nest, because obviously nesting right beside a sort of raging torrent like that is a bit dodgy, but they're adapted for it. When they fledge, they'll know what to do. And here's one fascinating bit of information. Dippers are very, very faithful to their nest sites, and one nest site has been used by dippers for 123 years. That's faithful, isn't it? So that site we've just seen could have been used for decades by those birds. Right, remember that quiz? Let us now remind ourselves. I asked you what these were. Okay, now I'll just have a look, some of the answers. Here we go. I like this one very much. This is coming from John Marley on Facebook. They look like my wife Gloria's sausage rolls and considerably more palatable too. John, mate, you're living on borrowed time. But many of you, Becky Whitworth, Eric Bickerton, Luby Lulu and Batman, they all got it right. 98% of you got it absolutely right. These are caddisfly larvae cases. Now, the caddisfly, the living bit, lives inside, I don't know if you can see, and it's quite soft, the body of the caddisfly, so it needs to protect itself by making this protective case. But how does it do it? Come on, let's go into micro world. Come with me. Here we are. We're in the production village again. We're going to micro world to try and find out how do they do it. Find out a bit more about caddisflies. Right, I mustn't squash these. In we go. Oh, come on in. So here we are, once again, in Microworld. And just to remind you, we've got sort of miniature setups of the habitats you can find here at Unis here. We've got a pond, we've got a sort of sedge bog, and we've got the forest here. Now, we filmed inside here, we actually filmed the caddisflies. Let's have a look at what we filmed. Now, they are the strangest creatures. You can see the soft insect is inside, the larva, and it's created all around it this protective shield. Now, in the UK, we've got 189 different species of caddisfly, can you believe? And quite often, you can identify the different types of caddisfly by the materials that they use to build that protective case. Strange-looking creatures, very, very familiar. Fishermen know them very well. They call them sedge flies. Most curious things. We're steaming up a little bit, but that's live telly, folks. Now let's have another close look. How do they produce these little protective cases? Let's have another look. Now, they actually create a little bit of sticky silk, which they attach to the little piece, each individual piece, and then stick it to one another. And you can see it's beautifully constructed. Look at that. Like a little bit of crazy paving. They're fantastically good at building them. It's wonderful how they cement them together. Beautiful little animal. And they're very, very common. Terribly important part of river ecology. And the dippers that we saw, they eat them too. And let's have a very quick look. What does the adult look like? Hang on a minute. That is an adult caddisfly. Immense antennae it's got. So there we go, caddisfly. We'll come back to microworld. So now, let us leave the small and go to the huge and dramatic, back to Yolo and those gannets.
I've been finding out more about the life of one of the UK's most impressive seabirds, the gannet. Their success may be down to their unique hunting style, and today we're going to try and capture that in action.
Back to Bass Rock, and you think that with nearly 60,000 pairs of gannets on there, it would be the easiest thing in the world to film this spectacular fishing technique they have. Actually, it's quite difficult, so fingers crossed.
To maximise our chances, I haven't come empty-handed. Mackerel are one of the gannets' favourite foods. And the fish soon get their attention.
See these birds circling? We've got hundreds of birds overhead now, and they'll do this whenever they come across a food source, shoal of fish. And this can happen miles offshore.
With their streamlined shape and a wingspan of nearly 6 feet, gannets are perfectly adapted for life on the wing. When food is scarce, they've been known to travel over 1,000 miles in search of fish. The birds here today haven't had to travel that far, but they still have a healthy appetite.
Unlike other seabirds, they can eat the fish whole underwater. And the big advantage of that is when they come up, they're not going to be mobbed by other gannets and the bigger gulls.
But it's the spectacular plunge dive that's the gannet's trademark. And that's what I want to find out more about. I've come prepared with a team of experienced divers and some really high-tech kit.
What we're going to try and do using this camera here is get slow motion pictures of the gannet as it hits the water and then goes after the fish. If we can get that and slow that right down, that should be superb.
The water is currently a bracing 7 degrees. But if this works, it'll be worth it.
Oh. All of a sudden, the sea's full of gannets! Full of gannets! I can feel the impact when they hit the water. It is one of the most incredible experiences, wildlife experiences, I've ever had. It really is. And they're big birds! Big, big birds!
It's fascinating to witness, but each dive lasts just seconds. To see what's really going on, we need to slow it down. The results are spectacular. Now I'm really beginning to understand what makes gannets so special. They hit the water like missiles at speeds of over 30 miles an hour. The impact on their bodies must be extraordinary, but gannets are built to dive. An airbag in their chest inflates to cushion the impact. As they enter the water, their wings fold back like arrows, making them super streamlined. But beneath the surface, wings turn into flippers, propelling them after their prey and allowing gannets to dive deeper than most other birds. Seeing them in action like this, it's no surprise to me that gannets are doing so well.
To be up on the boat watching gannets dive into the water is something. To be down here with them really is an experience of a lifetime.
Well, wow is the word for it. That was absolutely amazing. Yolo's here right now with us. I'm so jealous of you. That must have been a fantastic experience.
It was. And if I had a wildlife bucket list, Michaela,
diving with plunging gannets would be right up there with the best. It really was an
You're
amazing
You're a lucky
experience.
Boy.
I am.
Now, we asked for questions for Yolo. We've got a pertinent one about the gannets from Jackie on Twitter. What top speed can gannets reach when they're diving?
Well, they can dive from about 30 metres up. That's 100 foot. And they can reach speeds of about 100 kilometres an hour, 60 miles an hour.
Really?
Now, that is an incredible impact when they hit that water. And I've got a gannet skull here, and you can see that it's streamlined. You know, there's a very smooth joint between the beak and the skull. Birds have nostrils, usually at the base of the beak. Gannet's nostrils open into the beak itself, and so the rushing water doesn't damage the eyes and the brains there as well. They also have air sacs. We've got some film here showing them coming into the water. Here they come. Look at that. They have air sacs behind the skin of the face and the chest too, and they have these incredibly strong necks, and all of that acts as a buffer for this amazing impact that they have.
Were you not a little bit worried when you were under the water that one might hit your head? Because that would hurt at that speed.
That would hurt, and I did think, am I going to leave this water with a gannet stuck in my skull? But I didn't. And I wasn't worried because they have incredible vision as well. They have binocular vision when they look down, and so they can see fish from a great height. So they knew I was there, they knew where the fish was. But once they get underwater, their vision is not very good. It's just like ours. But of course, you don't need very good vision to find a big fish.
Is that why three of them in the film went for one fish? I mean, this is astonishing.
This is astonishing. They squabble, you know, because we were throwing in fish. That's a valuable resource for them. They will go over 100 miles to look for food. We were throwing in food right underneath Bass Rock, and they gathered in masses. And so they came down, they squabble on the surface, they squabble underwater, and there's something of a debate, too, as to whether gannets swallow the fish whole underwater. Some people say they do, some people say they don't. We saw one swallow one virtually whole.
Well, a fantastic experience for you. You've been out and about filming all throughout the spring. What can we look forward to over the next few days and, in fact, the next couple of weeks?
Well, on Thursday, I'll be up at Lake Vyrnwy looking at hen harriers, beautiful male here, one of the most beautiful birds of prey. Another stunning bird of prey is the kites. I'll be in Oxfordshire.
Whoa,
just
look at that.
Talon
Amazing.
Grappling pair there. And also up in Aberdeen, looking at bottlenosed dolphins. And up there, they grow to 4 metres long.
Well, we look forward to all of that. Thanks very much, Yolo, for coming in. Chris, I guess you must have been to Bass Rock at some time, have you?
I have. It's a global spectacular, truly amazing. But I've come down now, on a very dingy evening, to the edge of our woodland here, because just up over the top of this bank, in amongst the trees, is our great tit's nest. Let's go live to those great tits now, and you can see one of the birds is in there brooding them. Just like the jackdaws, this doesn't surprise me at all. It's a very cool evening. He or she has got 5 chicks down underneath them, but they've been busy all day. What have they been up to? Well, they've been in and out, as we've seen, despite the rain. One of the little chicks decided to go for a sort of swim around the nest, and this paid dividends because it was out and therefore perhaps more noticeable than the others, so that when the adult did come in, after it sort of leered at the camera, it got a caterpillar for its trouble. So there we are. Look at that, it's fantastic. The other thing that we saw today was our great tits were testing to see which of their young wanted the caterpillar the most. Look at the way that this adult is sticking that caterpillar in and out of all of those gapes and then finally depositing it. It's a smart little thing. Something's going on there, the nuances of which we probably don't yet fully understand. Now, behind me, if you look down and across the murky, grassy field here, you can see some barns. And last year, and the year before, if you were watching Springwatch, these were a hive of activity. They were filled with baby barn owls like this. And we all enjoyed some groovy times watching these birds. They were great characters. But what's going on over there at the moment? Well, I can tell you that everything is much later. Just like the bluebells, just like the toads, just like everything else, our barn owls have only just started laying their eggs. Now, this is the male, presumably, bringing in food to the female. When we last looked, there was just one egg in there. And what this means is that throughout the course of our programme this year, we're not going to rig them because basically we just get shots of a female barn owl sat there like this, incubating the eggs.
It's So does that mean we're going to get any chicks this year, Chris? We might do, right at the end of the series.
It's going to be very difficult. We won't rig a camera, of course, until those eggs hatch. So they are, even if they hatch, you know, right on time, it would be right at the end of our series. It could be good news for the barn owls. Just because it's cold and late doesn't really matter so much, as long as plenty of voles about in the summer. And it's not unusual to see baby barn owls in the nest very late in the year, even up till Christmas.
Well, right by those barn owls and right by the barn, we had little rabbits, baby rabbits, earlier on. Look, there they are. I know you probably don't like fluffy little rabbits, Chris, but you've got to admit that's quite sweet. Quite sweet?
Yeah, it's a bunny. Yes, of course. These are wonderful animals. They have an extraordinary life, actually. I think we underestimate just how interesting the social life and the biology of rabbits is. Or they get up to all sorts of fascinating things underground, as I find out in my Burrowers series, which is going to form part of the Summer of Wildlife later this year.
But could that little bunny be fodder for our barn owls?
Unlikely.
Probably a bit big.
Unlikely.
A bit big now.
Unlikely. But there is another bird, and we can go live to our buzzard now. These are very fond of eating rabbits. Now, it's got very dark down there underneath the trees. And I think in a contest to find the world's most miserable, sodden buzzard, this is a contender. But it's also a buzzard that's doing a great job. And I can tell you that tomorrow it's meant to be sunny here, Michaela. Great news for us, but perhaps great news for that really stoic female buzzard as well.
Now, I think the film that we showed yesterday that definitely deserved the Oscar for wildlife drama was the update on our osprey, starring Monty the male osprey and his love nest. Well, the drama continues tonight. It's a bit of a love tangle.
At the Montgomeryshire Wildlife Trust Reserve, just up the road from us, the male osprey, Monty, is alone. His long-term partner, Nora, didn't return from Africa this year and is feared dead. Monty did attract another female named Seren, who stuck around for a few days, taking advantage of Monty's fishing skills to feed up after her long journey. But she soon disappeared. Had she just used Monty to provide some convenient meals before heading off to find another male? Now Monty's been left alone again, and the breeding season is in full swing. But he's not single for long. A new female named Blue FS arrives in the estuary. She's a Scottish bird and was ringed back in 2010 near Loch Ness. As a three-year-old, this would be her first breeding season. Monty works hard to impress this new female. He provides 10 fish within 24 hours. But Blue FS still shows no signs of allowing him to mate. Is she unimpressed? Or perhaps, as a breeding novice, she's just too young and inexperienced to understand his courtship. She seems to be easily confused. Or she could just be pulling his leg. Fortunately, Monty appears to be a patient and tolerant partner. Eventually, she settles on the nest and looks quite at home. But who's this, flying in like a rocket? It's Seren. She's back, and she means business. After looking around and perhaps realising that Monty is quite a catch after all, she's decided to fight for her man. Seren soon sees off Blue FS and takes her place back on the nest. Monty seems confused. He just wants to breed. And all this hunting to provide fish for a succession of females must be exhausting. Now Seren and Monty are running late and need to get on with courtship and breeding if they're to produce chicks this year. Just as the situation seems to have settled down, there's yet another intruder. The very next day, a massive female named Glesney turns up. She has a leg ring, Blue 12, that shows she's from Rutland and was ringed in 2010, so this is also her first breeding season. Glesney circles overhead
and Monty now tries to see her off. There's an almighty chase that goes on for an exhausting 7 hours. But all the while, Seren is hungry. She relies on Monty to bring her food, but he's busy, engaged in aerial combat. Monty continues to chase off Glesny for a couple of days, defending his nest from this intruder. But this big girl is persistent. She wants him, and she wants his nest. Monty has a difficult decision to make. Does he carry on defending Seren, or accept this third mate? In the end, the decision is made for him. Seren appears to have thrown in the towel, and who can blame her for conceding defeat? Glesny's enormous, one of the biggest ospreys known. Finally, Monty accepts Glesny. It's an unusual way to woo a girl, but it's ultimately successful. Glesny settles in for the long haul, but after all the mate-swapping shenanigans, have they left it too late to have young this year?
What a to-do!
That's an
three ladies, all after Monty. Have they left it too late, Chris?
It's a long process, isn't it? Incubating and then rearing their young and then building up strength to get back to West Africa. It's going to be touch and go. It's going to be a great story, that's for sure.
It's going to be a great story. Going to be close.
Provided a lot of drama already.
Yes. Quick look at some glorious photographs. May I start? Look at that.
Oh, that's very pretty.
Pearl-bordered fritillary on blue. Andy Seeley. 7 minutes. That's gorgeous on a British bluebell. Oh.
I've got Great Tit versus Meadow Pipit from Kathleen Everett. Very good.
That's lovely.
You like that?
I've got this one. Barbie Lindsay. Barbie Lindsay. It's a rove beetle on dandelion. I like the abstract nature of that.
That's
one.
That's lovely, that. Look at that.
And here we are.
Bee
Look,
fly.
What about this one? We've got to finish with this one. This one's a beauty. Stephen Ward. Kestrel over car. This was hovering right above his van. And this ties in perfectly because tomorrow, coming up, is a film about a bird which I've obsessed about since I was a teenager, the kestrel. We're going to be investigating their decline, launching a survey and finding out what we can do to help their numbers.
Well, we've got cliffhangers galore. What is going to happen in the jackdaw nest? Now, remember, we've got those intruders. The chicks are all right now, but will they still be all right tomorrow? And now our mallard. She's sitting on those eggs. Oh, look at the gloom. When will they hatch out? Will they make it to the river?
We'll be back tomorrow at 7:30, not 8 o'clock, because after Springwatch will be Springwatch Unsprung, where we'll be answering your questions, looking at more photos and listening to your observations in a fun and factual way. Don't forget, Nick Baker is back tomorrow afternoon at 3 o'clock for Springwatch in the afternoon, and Springwatch Extra is on straight after us on the red button and on the internet as well. So don't forget, we'll be back tomorrow at
7:30.
We'll see you then from us. Bye-bye for now.
Good night.